Hello, Peter. Nice to see you. Now, we thought we'd like to put together a video after the UKCP's webinar and put through some points that came up, some observations that we encountered because of it. Do you want to let people know who you are briefly, and I'll do the same?
Yes, my name is Peter Jenkins. I'm a member of Talkful Therapists, and I was on the UKCP Ethics Committee a long time ago, but I'm not leaning on that for this particular talk. So I have a particular interest in legal and ethical issues around the whole UKCP MOU debate.
And I'm an existential psychotherapist and counsellor just in private practice who wrote against queer theory because I was concerned about queer ideologies encroachment in the therapy profession. Now, the UKCP's webinar was quite an interesting event where they went into a lot more detail about their reasoning behind pulling out of the Memorandum of Understanding against conversion therapy, which was quite an interesting occasion. What were your thoughts about, firstly, their decision to do it in the first place and the legal implications of it?
Well, the UKCP took a very brave step, I think, in deciding to leave the MOU. It was, in fact, the first organisation to do this. But, I mean, given the weight of UKCP and I think the prestige with which it's regarded by most psychotherapists and counsellors in the UK, it really has had a massive impact on the whole discussion, the whole debate.
So I've got, I suppose,
a sense that there are really three issues that are at the heart of this debate, this discussion, this dilemma for UKCP members in the vote that they're facing. And the first is about exploratory therapy and what that entails now. Secondly, I think, are issues arising from the CAS reforms. And the third, as you mentioned, are potential conflicts between the MOU, the Memorandum of Understanding, and legal issues, which really do carry some weight in this. So quite happy to talk about those three areas.
And those first two are certainly, you know, they're important as well because they give the context as well to what was going on. So do you want to tackle those for a second?
And I'll start with the issue of exploratory therapy. And the history of this debate go back to November of last year when UKCP issued a statement that exploratory therapy should not in any circumstances be confused with conversion therapy. Now, this is a very conflicted debate. Now, if we look at the MOU, the Memorandum of Understanding on Conversion Therapy, then if we read the text carefully, it really provides only very grudging acknowledgement of the role of exploratory therapy with gender-questioning clients. So it restricts exploratory therapy to those who are unhappy, uncertain, or in distress. And in fact, well, it's particularly, it doesn't seem to address the needs of clients who may be gender questioning, who are completely certain about their gender identity. And it may well be that as therapists, it's exactly those clients who might benefit from some gentle exploration within therapy rather than those who are overtly wanting to question or challenge it. And I think, the chair of the MOU has in fact gone further with this sense of reservation about the role of exploratory therapy and giving evidence to the Scottish Parliament in 2021. The chair of the MOU said, but the extended exploration of someone's traumatized history is really a way of preventing them from being able to live their life and have the gender or sexual orientation that they wish to have, end of quote. So there's a sense here as though therapists wanting to do exploratory work with clients, which is our bread and butter, if you like, as therapists, that this is really a way of trying to hold gender questioning clients back from their true path. It's trying to thwart their intentions. Whereas, I mean, nobody would seek to uncover or explore trauma unnecessarily, but it may well be there is a relationship between past trauma, past sexual abuse, co-occurring conditions like depression, anxiety, autism and so on, which may have a bearing on the client's situation.
Indeed. I guess my concern is it has the potential to then kind of scare therapists into not asking some very challenging questions, you know, where part of our role in therapy is to ask those more difficult questions at times to get people to think. What they do with that is then up to them. But if we're not permitted to ask those questions, then that's not therapy.
Sure. I mean, I would see, and I don't think this is a maverick view, that exploratory work really is a core part of every therapy modality, that whatever point of the compass we're coming from, we were seeking to explore with the client.
Yeah, and you've done some great work to highlight that.
Sure, thank you. I mean, the CAS review has recognized this in relation to gender questioning young people. And again, it says, quote, exploration of these issues is essential to provide diagnosis, clinical support, and appropriate intervention, end of quote. So CAS is, I think, trying to pick a way through this and not wanting to come down on either side, on exploratory therapy, not a modality on its own, or a gender affirmative therapy, but it's really saying explicitly that exploratory work within therapy is really important for clients.
And, you know, to have that recognized by CAS has been really valuable and important.
Sure. I mean, if we look at the recent history of this, then, I mean, the MOU is very carefully worded and it doesn't explicitly require therapists to use gender, what I would say, gender identity affirming therapy in our work with clients. But that was the way it was interpreted and applied at the Tavistock, the Gender Identity Development Service.
And that's the problem, isn't it, of this document? It's how it was intended and then how it's been applied. And they're two, three different things.
Sure, yes. And I mean, and again, going back to CAS, the interim review by CAS described this process as diagnostic overshadowing. That is, where someone self-declares a gender identity, then in many cases, certainly at the Tavistock, it seemed as though exploratory therapy would then be considered unnecessary because that really hit the nail on the head. This was going to be the working hypothesis, or, you know, whatever language we might want to use. But in practice, as we know from the work of people like Hannah Barnes, then this kind of affirmation fed into a process of rapid medicalization and quite devastating longer-term health consequences for many young clients. So that's really about the role of exploratory therapy. And I think what I'm suggesting here is that there is the beginnings of a clash between the MOU, the memorandum, and the CAS reforms. And I know that there is a lot of reservations and hostility towards the CAS reforms, but they're coming down the track. This is going to be new policy. So it is about understanding it and applying it rather than simply rejecting it.
The CAS review has been accepted by most political parties and various organizations. Can you just say some more then about kind of the CAS review and its relationship to all of this?
Sure. Yes. I mean, it seems to me that the CAS review takes a public health approach to the whole question of developing services for gender questioning young people. And I mean, this is set within a very broadly established model within healthcare. And this approach uses an evidence-based model. It relies on systematic reviews of the available, usually moderate to high quality evidence, and caution in using medical approaches what it sees is a key primary role for therapy and for psychological interventions, rather than moving, as I said, rapidly to medical interventions. And Cass has identified some of the problems that she anticipates in relation to fears by practitioners that if they use exploratory therapy, then allegations will be made that, in fact, practitioners are using conversion therapy. So that she sees that as a factor which really
finds. And it's sort of valid, considering I think there was a situation where a sting was set up, sort of like an operation where they tried to prove that the therapist was working ineffectively, where all the therapist was doing exploratory therapy, but because they didn't affirm, then this was sort of deemed to be inappropriate.
Yes, yeah. And I mean, if it's not the case of an actual instance, there have been these examples both in America and in the UK, then it would be reasonable to be concerned that the exploratory or challenging responses by a therapist might be experienced and interpreted by the client as being conversion therapy, even if that was not the intent. So, I mean, Cass has identified this as a major issue in trying to implement these reforms. And partly this relates to the fluidity of the concept of gender identity. So on the one hand, it's innate, it's fixed, it's immutable. But on the other hand, it's also supposed to be subject to rapid fluctuation and change.
Which was really helpful. Yeah, this has never been properly pinned down and clarified as to what it is to say. Yeah.
Yes. So, and I think this anxiety, according to Cass, it really hampers and deters some therapists from wanting to work with this client group. So there's likely to be a shortfall of professionals who feel empowered and confident in working in this area. And it does seem to be leading to problems in staffing with the two regional hubs, which have been set up to replace the Tavistock. I mean, the other issue about the MOU is, of course, that it's very strongly influenced by WPATH, the World Professional Association for Transgender Health. And again, Cass was critical of the WPATH Standards of Care 8.
Which I would pick up on, because that's where the Memorandum of Understanding was actually drafted on the basis of queer ideology, which is very different to what most people understand the previous LGB rights movement to be adhering to, because queer ideology only came out sort of properly in, I'd argue, the mid-90s, whereas the early gay rights movement was very much in like 60s, 70s and 80s. And it reframes a lot of definitions that have been from the previous movement embedded in law, but queer ideology changes those definitions. So the concepts that you previously understood to relate to these definitions are no longer the same. And I don't think that's been made particularly clear by WPATH or by the Coalition Against Conversion Therapy, who drafted the Memorandum of Understanding.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, we know that key members, key figures within the MOU were also members of WPATH until quite recently. Clearly, that's their right if they wish to do that. But I think you can trace the influence of WPATH's approach, which in many ways I think is quite a narrow, quite partisan approach about harm reduction. And a lot of that language then feeds through the MOU. The MOU is a complex document, has to be read very carefully. It, as you say, it is very much invested with queer theory. And so, for example, it reverses the burden of proof. Mm-hmm. So it's not about an individual being subject to an accusation that they're practicing in a discriminatory way, but it's more about the individual therapist having to prove that they're not doing that. I mean, this is kind of inverting.
Very, very different.
The whole kind of power relationship and the expectation that practitioners can be trusted to practice with integrity. It's about proving that there isn't this implicit assumption that one gender identity is preferable to another. I mean, again, very briefly, WPATHs see only a very marginal role for psychotherapy in relation to gender questioning clients. So, for example, the standards of care 8 say, quote, counseling or psychotherapy specifically focused on their TGD, that is transgender and gender diverse identity, is not a requirement. Mm-hmm. So, end of quote. So that it really is the case that therapy is marginal rather than, as Cass perceives it, as being central to that process of exploration. And I think
tried to get therapy out of the way, which actually is a point where maybe it's important for people to understand the history of the trans movement, because there are a lot of different people that have come to be under the umbrella of trans. And I don't think everybody's really aware of that. It kind of started with the idea of kind of being transsexual in the after post-operative interventions. You could then take on the body of the opposite sex, and that is what was previously referred to as transsexual. People who were waiting for surgery were referred to as being transgender. So they changed themselves culturally, but not medically. So, you know, they were still on waiting lists. They were still undergoing the therapeutic process in order to address any issues in relation to it. And after a while, these people that considered themselves to be transgender kind of went, well, you know what, actually, we quite like being transgender. We don't really want to go through the medical route. And so we're going to identify as being trans and have that be okay. And I think a lot of people haven't understood that this transgender community are very different to the transsexual community. And then along from that, the trans, what previously was referred to as the transvestite community, just men who enjoyed cross-dressing, for example, then they kind of looked at what the transgender community were doing and kind of going, actually, that's very similar to what we're doing. So, you know, they're all of these people under the umbrella of trans. And even within those communities, there are people who adhere to queer ideology and people who don't. And yet they've all been swept along on this route. And, you know, there's no real definition of what trans is as a result. And so it can range from somebody who is a post-operative transsexual to somebody who just likes to wear a wig and lipstick on the weekends. You know, that's a lot of people to encompass when it comes to legal definitions.
Sure. And I mean, within the law, you can see this tension in terms of the way that the protected characteristic of gender reassignment has been widely interpreted and applied within policies ranging from schools to organizations, universities, National Health Service, and so on, in terms of transgender. Well, of course, trans or transgender is not a protected characteristic as such under the Equality Act 2010. It's about gender reassignment. So that, you know, there's this kind of push.
Distinction, yeah.
Well, yes, yeah. I mean, very briefly, the other, and I think these are really important in terms of the current debate within the UKCP about the MOU. The other areas relate to the law and potential legal difficulties for the UKCP. I mean, one of the striking points about the memorandum is that it was never clear as to whether it applied to adults or whether it also incorporated children under 18. This is an absolutely essential distinction within
and the UKCP
legal system.
Yep, and the UKCP really were very clear on driving that point home in their webinar.
Sure. Because in terms of consent, for example, then there are very different standards for adults who are over the age of 18 and for under 18s. And there are key legal questions that would need to be resolved, I think, in relation to question of capacity, informed consent, and clearly about safeguarding. I mean, safeguarding has become something of a political football, at the moment, because the activist groups say, yes, there are safeguarding issues, as almost as much as those who would want to critique the MOU.
Well, but I think a different idea of what safeguarding constitutes, doesn't it?
Very, very different ideas. And so I think there are different, quite difficult issues to be looked at in detail about capacity and informed consent, which are not addressed by the MOU. I mean, it's a one-page, two-page document. And I think these complexities are not resolved by simply referring to the Gillick decision for England, Wales, and Northern Ireland, or to the Age of Legal Capacity Act 1991 for Scotland. They're much more complex than this, and there is a silence within the MOU about this.
Why do you think that Gillick is not adequate enough in that respect?
Well, I think that came to light in the judicial review that was brought by Kirabel and others against the Tavistock and was heard in December 2020. And the judges looked very, very closely at whether or not a young person under the age of 16 could have the capacity, that is almost the adult intelligence, in order to make lifelong decisions about fertility, about really undergoing major surgery, for example, changing perhaps their life expectancy. So whether or not a young person ranging from 10 to 15 could really adequately deal with the information presented to them, weigh it in the balance and make a decision. They also queried whether young people under 18, that is 16 and 17-year-olds, who can make legal decisions under Section 8 of the 1969 Family Law Reform Act, they also questioned whether they would have the capacity to do this and whether those cases should be heard in court, or on the Australian model, if you like. But, of course, that was overturned. There was a challenge to that, and the outcome of that was whatever the rights and wrongs of capacity for children, these issues had to be decided by the medical practitioners, which has always been the traditional understanding of Gillick. But Gillick is not a blank check.
Problem, isn't it? You know, yeah. There has been a misapplication of Gillick, you know, and children, you know, to understand their life choices in relation to fertility issues at the age of 15 or 16 is, you know, that's asking a lot of a 15 or 16-year-old.
Well, certainly, I mean, there is case law. I mean, you may have heard of the book, what's it, The Children Act, which they made a film about. It was a boy who was a Jehovah's Witness under the age of 18 who was refusing a blood transfusion on grounds of religion. And the courts decisively intervened to overturn that. So for life-changing health decisions, the courts will intervene to prevent that happening. And so under 18s do not have this magic power of adolescent autonomy in every possible case.
And that's very clear in the law, and that's what the MOU doesn't cover.
Absolutely. And the very final point, I think, which is relevant to the UKCP, and I think really has driven their decision to withdraw from the MOU and to take the stance of great caution that they are doing, is about the changing nature of the case law. Since the legal case brought by Mayor Forstatter in 2021, there's been a whole succession of cases at a employment tribunal level. And there is a developing case law here where it's absolutely clear that citizens in the UK, therapists, if you like, have a right to hold and to express gender-critical views, even if that causes offence. I think one of the arguments has been, well, you can hold and express views, but you mustn't offend people, which means you wouldn't have a right to, you could hold your rights silently, if you like. Well, that's not the law. You can hold and express them. Now, the UKCP, I think, have taken note of this, because On the one hand, you have the MOU, which is not a legal document. It's a policy document of interprofessional cooperation around conversion therapy.
Indeed. And the UKCP, again, they were very keen to, in the webinar, to highlight that this was intended as a campaigning document. You know, it was an activist-led intervention to try and raise awareness about it. However, you know, it wasn't meant to be used as a legal document, even though it's now being used in legal cases.
Yes, yeah. So I think what the UKCP board have recognized is, with this developing case, which all seems to be going one way at the moment in support of the rights of gender-critical therapists, that there is inevitably going to be a clash at some stage between UKCP members who hold gender-critical views and who work in an exploratory way. And the clash will be between their right to do that in law and the expectations that they will follow the MOU, which is part of their code of ethics. Now, if it comes to that clash, I would have thought that case law is going to predominate because the MOU is a non-legal document. So the UKCP very sensibly have looked at this. They can see the iceberg, which they're rocketing towards, and they're steering away from it. It does make enormous sense to avoid expensive and unwinnable litigation. And that, I think, informs the UKCP decision.
Well, it does. But they were also very keen to point out that, you know, it was the insurance companies that perhaps pointed out the iceberg rather than them. The insurance premiums have gone up as a result of the case law. So, now, if they've spotted the iceberg, great. But the way they presented it in the webinar was more the case that the insurance companies have spotted the iceberg. And as a result, they have to listen and adhere to that.
Well, insurance companies, and no doubt medical insurance companies in the future, are listening very, very carefully to this kind of somewhat abstruse debate amongst therapists and medics and so on. And they're looking at the bottom line, which is there a risk of a court case here? If there is a risk of a court case, is it going to be winnable? Or is it likely that it's kind of indefensible in law? So I think you're right. Yes, the risk of enormous heightened costs of it, medical insurance, professional indemnity insurance, has got to be a major factor here. But that's a reading of the legal situation. Mm-hmm. Insurance companies, they're going to want to protect their assets here.
Oh, indeed. And, you know, quite understandably so. I guess, where does that all of that leave us therapists, really?
Well, I mean, we could debate the rights and wrongs of the MOU at length, but I think the position taken by the UKCP board is the right one under the circumstances. It's one of caution. It's saying there are difficulties, there are things that are unclear that need to be resolved. We need debate and discussion, and I think, in the absence of certainty, that they're advocating to stay out of the MOU for the time being would seem to be the prudent and appropriate step to take.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. You know, they acknowledged themselves it was very difficult. Like, they didn't communicate things effectively, but they were in a very difficult position at the time, but they sort of acknowledged that they will learn from that. But they are very clear about wanting to include a lot of different voices in the working group to build up a more detailed a document that is more legally binding when it comes to conversion therapy. And they're inviting lots of different members and organizations. They were very keen to reassure, particularly the LGBTQ community, that they were against the principles of conversion therapy and that they want to include them and any working group being drafted going forward. What I was concerned about, though, in their webinar is that there didn't seem to be any acknowledgement of any perhaps more, you know, sex realism or gender critical, whichever term you prefer to use, voices to be included in these working documents as well. And I would like to see a lot more people that perhaps don't believe in queer ideology also stepping forward, particularly in the lesbian and gay community. I think it's very important that their voices are included when it comes to drafting this potentially new document.
Yes, I would agree with that. I mean, I think for the past 3 or 4 years, certainly since the Curabel judicial review, that it's been very frustrating for therapists that there hasn't been an open and free debate about this. And it would be wonderful if that began to really take root and flourish within the UKCP. I think that would be a massive step forward and something of an example to the other professional associations that their approach seems to be there's no debate, just batten down the hatches and, you know, we will be fine. Well, I think UKCP is sounding the warning signal here that it's not all as well with that kind of policy.
Yeah. Exactly. Should we leave it there, Peter?
Yes, that's fine. Yes, brilliant.
It was lovely to speak with you.